You're listening to Viewpoint, a podcast of Highlands Church. Hey, welcome everyone. Viewpoint is a podcast discussing challenging cultural issues from the Bible's point of view. And we want to equip the church to be able to encounter the world around us with the truth of the gospel. And I'm joined, as always, by our pastor of adult education, Joe Infranco. Welcome, Joe.
Thanks. And as always, great to be with you.
Awesome. And today we are talking about sex, faith, and identity. So much of our culture focuses on the idea of our identity, who we are, and how we perceive ourselves. We even hear a lot about identity politics that can pit groups against each other according to ideas related to identity. Some other common forms, there are lots of ways that we can base our identity in different areas, like our race or our political preferences, or even our job and what we do for a living. But in our culture today, by far the loudest and most persuasive voices, they're trying to convince us to base our identity in our sexual orientation, which is a way of saying the type of person to whom one feels sexually attracted or drawn. And we hear it in the acronym LGBTQ. Specifically, the letters identify a type of sexual attraction or a gender perception. Those stand for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer. But on a more fundamental level, do those stand for an identity? Or put another way, do these mean a person's attractions or desires equate in some way to their identity or the reality of who they are as a person or a central truth about their existence? And so today we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about what the Bible has to say about our identity, who we are in God's creative order. Where does the Bible say our identity even comes from? And then to answer the cultural question, what does the Bible teach about our desires and attractions? What about attractions that are to people of the same sex? Or do those desires or feelings define people in some way and become an identity? And also, importantly, how do we enter into meaningful, loving, grace-filled conversations with the people in our lives for whom that's a reality? So we've got some great guests with us today. They have great expertise in these challenging areas, and they are Gary and Melissa Ingram. In 2013, Gary and Melissa founded the Love and Truth Network. It's a national nonprofit ministry focused on equipping Christian leaders to develop safe and transformational environments with the purpose of restoring sexual wholeness and biblical identity. So this is right up their alley. They have an incredible amount of resources, including training courses and seminars and a weekly podcast of their own, so much more. Gary and Melissa, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much. Glad to be with you guys.
Yeah, thanks.
And Joe, you have worked with Gary and Melissa in the past, and they've just been a blessing to our church already in our history together.
Yeah, and let me just set this up. Why is this such an important question? We want to think through the way people use terms and the meaning behind certain words. You know, and by the way, the same word doesn't always have the same meaning to two people. We want to be careful in evaluating ideas and all that. The idea of identity is interesting. You know, there are certain types of identity I have. I'm a New York Yankees fan. I'm Italian-American. I grew up in an Italian culture and all that. These are aspects of identity. So it's something that I identify with, but it doesn't define who I am. Where identity becomes tricky is when identity is establishing something in us that's contrary to what the Bible teaches. And sometimes that becomes a question of, well, this is who I am, this is how I feel, or something along those lines. And spoiler alert, we know what the scripture says, which is that we have a new identity. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone's in Christ, he or she is a new creation. Old things have passed away, all things have become new. So there's an identity that God gives us as believers that's a separate idea from the way we might identify with a sports team or a fraternal organization or something like that. And I can think of no better guests with whom to explore this kind of tension. And again, this is so important because if the message that a lot of people are getting about some of these topics relating to sex, if the message they're getting is somehow, this is my identity, if it's something we would say immutable, it can't be changed, something like your race or your sex, then your world begins to orient around that because it's a given that cannot be or should not be questioned. that's why this becomes such a critical, you know, such a critical subject. So Gary and Melissa, it's a delight to have you here again. Can you give our listeners just a kind of a brief summary of your background? What led you to start the ministry?
Sure. So we'll just quickly summarize. We have long form testimonies on our website that people can check out if they like. But to summarize quickly, I grew up in a Christian home, youngest of five kids. I have one older sister, three older brothers. And I just didn't feel like I fit in the world of boys and men. And I felt very much pushed out of that world. I wasn't rough and tumble like my other siblings, my other brothers, and a lot of the boys in the neighborhood and at school and at church. And I didn't know what was different about me, but I felt like I just didn't fit. I fit in more with girls. I was more interested in the things they were interested in, that kind of thing. My dad really kind of left me to be raised by my mom. And so all of this, along with at the age of five or six, being introduced to a neighborhood boys' father's hardcore porn, some older neighborhood boys thought it'd be great fun to expose me to that trash. And that had a serious impact on my life. That had a very serious impact on the trajectory of my life. I was already dealing with deep sense of shame about who I was as a boy. And then by the time I hit puberty, there was no internet back then, thank goodness, thank the Lord. But I could find pornography. Even though I lived in the middle of nowhere in the country, I could still had access to finding this stuff. And that, again, really set in all the while going to church, all the while going to the motions of Christianity. It really set in this deep sense of shame and having something severely wrong with me. And at some point, I just began to turn more and more away from God as I was praying for him to take away these desires toward sexuality, toward, in this case, I was dealing with same-sex attraction. I realized at one point I was horrified by that, more interested in the images of guys than of women. And so this really just led to a lot of years of suppression, a lot of years of self-belittling, self-hatred, and really the envying and exalting other boys in particular as being much better at everything than kind of myself. And so when that self-hatred and that envy became pretty deeply sexualized, that really put my life on a course toward this sense that, oh, I was born this way. This is the way I've always felt. I found my first gay bar at the age of 19 after leaving Bible college and feeling like I'm done with church, I'm done with Christianity, I'm done with God. And it felt euphoric for quite a period of time. But eventually, I began to feel this wearing and decay of my soul. And eventually, I came to genuine faith in Christ around the age of 23 or so. And that was kind of a rocky, bumpy start, big honeymoon period for a period of time of walking with Christ. And then really this resurgence of same-sex attraction, didn't know how to deal with that. The church still wasn't dealing with that effectively. God brought me to a church that we often refer to as a hospital church, that those kinds of churches that are really equipped to and looking for really broken people. And sadly, most churches are not doing that. And so God brought me to this church in my mid-30s, and they really, through this course of time, I experienced a lot of transformation in my life through that connection with the church.
Melissa, tell a little bit of your story, BC, and then let's take it up to the time that the two of you meet and marry, and God does incredible work in your lives.
Yes. So I grew up in a religious home, but my dad was on the road a lot with his business, and my mom was working full time. Kind of in their absence, I was exposed to a lot of to pornography and somewhat sexually abusive behavior by my brother, my older brother, and so I began to believe that it wasn't desirable to be a woman. I mean, I couldn't have told you that necessarily, but I began to detach from being a girl. And then after a series of relationships with boys and into college, I began to question my sexuality. And I started dating a woman my senior year of college. And this felt like what I had been looking for my whole life. And so again, really talking to your introduction, this idea that my feelings were driving my behavior and believing, okay, this is who I am. I'm a lesbian. Mm-hmm. And so what was so interesting was my twin sister, identical twin sister, got saved our freshman year of college. And so this is now our senior year, and she's at a different school, but she invited me to a conference where I heard a woman share her story of coming out of a lesbian relationship with a friend of hers. And she said what I think is so important for our discussion today, and it changed my life. She said, after reading the Bible and recognizing that the Bible did not say that this was okay, that this lesbian relationship was okay with her friend, she decided to follow God and follow the Bible. And she said, I realized that just because I felt something didn't make it right. And that had been my entire justification for this relationship. Like, it just felt so right. And so that day I repented. And so that was the beginning of a journey of really coming into agreement with who God created me to be as a woman. And Gary and I met in 2004 at a conference, leadership training, and we began to date the following summer. And part of that was we really knew that we'd been called to very similar ministry, which is to help others and to really equip the church to develop environments where people like us dealing with a range of sexual brokenness can experience transformation. So we were married in 2007. We have two boys. They are going to be 13 and 15 this summer. And so then we started Love and Truth Network in 2013. And you can always find out more about us at loveandtruthnetwork.com.
Yeah, it's so interesting to hear your backgrounds and to see some of the common types of, let me use the word brokenness as a placeholder here, including details like you were both exposed to pornography. So there's some combination of the family environment, the way we're created, whatever our natural talents or way of thinking might be, and you kind of incubate that and you add a few bad experiences and something like pornography, and the whole thing is kind of cooking up into some unholy mess, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let me go right to the main subject and throw this out to the two of you. The idea of identity is so critical here. And again, so many people hear identity and they don't think of it as just a preference or a wiring for something, but they take it further than that and they get into an almost philosophical realm, like by the nature of who I am, this is what I am. And that gets baked into the equation. Thoughts on that? What's the significance of the idea of identity? You can relate it to what the two of you went through individually. How did you at some point assume an identity? And perhaps you can speak somewhat about the process of coming to grips with, well, this is not really my identity. This is something I'm experiencing, a desire, an attraction, or whatever. But when did you have that kind of breaking free moment where you separated that from identity?
Well, you mentioned, Joe, the impact of pornography, and both of us also mentioned how identity, or the lack of a sense of identity, that it was good for me to be a boy, that somehow I fit in the world of boys, that I had what it took to be a boy and to become a man. And Melissa questioning also, was it actually good to be a girl? Was it good to be a woman? And the feelings that, no, those things are not good, that somehow we're broken in that sense. That played a huge role also in the numerous experiences and the numerous conclusions that somehow we don't fit into that world, we don't fit into that space. That, along with pornography and all the other things, played a huge role. Eventually, coming back to your question, eventually, though, the reality that we're going down this kind of downward spiral, we're going down the rabbit hole of pursuing what feels right to us, what felt euphoric in the beginning, coming out to the LGBT community, belonging, that sense of belonging, that sense of being able to find someone to settle down with and spend the rest of our life with of the same gender, that it feels like we fit together. But eventually, we know from scripture that that breaks down. The sexual sin has a deep scarring effect on our soul. And so it was in that space, and then in Jesus waiting for our willingness to say help, our willingness to say, maybe I don't have it all together. Maybe all the assumptions I've made about you and myself and all, maybe these are wrong. And really him and his mercy and his love coming into that space and revealing himself to us as, no, I did create you to be a boy. I did create you to be a girl. Your biology matters, and who you are internally matters. It fits with who you are biologically. And all of that began to make more sense when we came into alignment with our biology and with who God made us to be as image bearers. We believe that we are image bearers of God, male and female, of equal value, but different expressions of who God is.
Right. I apologize. Allow me to interrupt here because you said something that's so important. I just wanted to get Melissa's take on this too. And I hope we'll come back to what you were saying. There's a deep, you were talking about that feeling you had and wanting to fit in. There's a deep human kind of component in all of us in this world to know not only who we are, but what's our role? Where do we fit? What was I made to be? That just seems to be a drive that's in us. And I think that that's perhaps a God-created drive that's common, you know, to all of humanity, and it's meant to focus on the right way. But that drive is working against us because initially, it's the drive to understand who we are and how we fit in with the world around us, but it's maybe not being exposed to the gospel or yet understanding our role as a creation. And Melissa, do you have thoughts on that? Can you drill down on that perhaps a bit? And you have a counseling degree. Let me just add for our...
Yes, I was just about to say, as a counselor, I think it's very important to remember, and this is not politically correct, like what I'm about to say. People don't like this, but yet the scientific evidence shows it, is that children do best with a married mom and dad. And so that God-given desire to attach and to belong and to be safe and secure and to have a healthy, good enough, right? We don't need perfect parents, but we need good enough parents to model for us what it means to be a man made in the image of God for dads and moms to model what it means to be a woman made in the image of God. And we can't just swap that out with two moms or two dads. There's a vital piece then missing for that child of, you know, a dad and a mom, and then how they work together to raise that child. And so I really feel like developmentally, we need those healthy models because that's what children do. They imitate, they learn, that more is caught than taught. And so that's kind of what both Gary and I had to, in a way, undo. Is not only did we need to find our identity in Christ, which we're going to talk about that, but also our identity as, you know, in Gary's case, a man, and in my case, a woman.
Yeah, and those concepts of identity are so important, which is why it's a great first place to start. I guess I should also back up just a little bit because we're making a few assumptions in our conversations. And in case this happens to be somebody's first time listening to one of our episodes of the podcast, we here at Highlands Church, where Viewpoint is based out of, and Gary and Melissa, you guys as well, hold to an orthodox biblical view of sexuality in which God's design is one man, one woman for one lifetime. And that is the only design for how sexual activity is to be expressed. And so anything outside of that is something that the Bible would call sin. And so we're wrestling with this idea of things outside those bounds that God lays out in his word suddenly becoming not only something that people do, but something that people base their identity in. And that's the foundational shift and what we would say foundational danger that exists and trying to root that out. So Gary, you were talking about this idea of being an image bearer and why that needs to be the fundamental identity versus the other things which ultimately break down. Can you say more about that?
Sure. So in Genesis 1, 26 and 27, it's clear that God made us in his image, male and female. And so we see that distinction in our maleness and femaleness, and also God's intention. Jesus in Matthew 19 when asked about the topic of divorce, actually loops back to Genesis and affirms that God created us for a marriage to be between one man and one woman. And also he affirms that God only created two genders, male and female, period. And so by doing that, Jesus nullifies everything else that's outside of that. A lot of people say, well, Jesus said nothing about homosexuality. Jesus didn't say many things about many things. And also we believe that the whole scriptures are inspired by God and by the Holy Spirit. And we should not just take the red letter words of Jesus as the only authoritative part of the Bible. So regardless though, Jesus blessed one union between male and female in marriage, and he blessed the reality, came back to the reality that we're made in the image of God, male and female, period.
So Gary, a follow-up question for you and Melissa. So, you know, we hear this and we're looking at God's design. We're looking at biology. I mean, I don't say this to be mean-spirited, quite the opposite, but it takes one man and one woman in order to form a child, genetically speaking. Some people might look at what we're saying and might think, well, that's being mean now. What about two people of the same sex who love each other? Isn't this prejudicial or something like that? And we're not talking about this. This is not an attempt to denigrate anybody or make somebody feel bad. We're talking about there's a basic human design, and there's frankly for millennia been an understanding of the word marriage. There have been times that marriage has included, you know, more than one spouse, usually men having more than one wife, but there was always an understanding of the complementary biological nature of a man and a woman. If somebody says to you, yeah, but now what you're saying is mean-spirited, shouldn't this be about love? And if two people love each other, why isn't it a marriage? How would you answer that?
Well, I would just say, you know, that God loves us the way we are. He cannot accept us the way we are because of our sin. So one, we have to determine, what do we mean by love? Like, we toss that word around. And so is love just what I feel today towards that person? Or am I actually committing to them for a lifetime based on God's commitment to us? So a good friend of ours, she expressed it so eloquently that the gospel is written in our sexuality, like the covenantal sacrificial love of God is written in our sexuality. So Jesus dying for us is what we need to be reflecting in how we love one another. And I mean, to expand that, right? We can see that it was God's initiative towards us to make it right. There was nothing we could do to reach God. And so in that sense, I mean, it really is a masculine initiative, right? Like, so Jesus is the bridegroom and the church is the bride. So even going bigger picture than just one man and one woman, I mean, we're talking the theology, right, of the church. And I'm not a theologian, but I'm just saying it goes so much deeper than just our feelings of the day.
Yeah, and one of the things I would say, just to follow up with what Melissa is sharing, is there's a massive tragedy within the church and amongst many Christians where we have taken something as powerful as love and we have made it into such a tepid reality where it's nothing more than mere niceness. It's nothing more than affirming what somebody wants or desires, as Melissa was saying, maybe in the moment, maybe it's a season of their life. I have to say that I'm so grateful to my mom and dad, who never treated me horribly when I came out to them as gay and lived in that world for quite some time. They never treated me awfully, never kicked me out of the house, those kinds of things, but they never gave me what I wanted, which was their approval. And I'm so grateful. The best gift they could have ever given me is not giving me what I wanted, which at the time I interpreted as love. And so as Christians, we have to learn how to root our love in the scriptures. So 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, verse 6, says that love does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. So many of us as Christians are loving in such a worldly and convenient kind of way. The biblical love is often much, much deeper and doesn't always feel as good to the recipient as a worldly, just affirmative kind of so-called love. And I think we need to start making distinction about what that looks like within the church.
Yeah, it's a great point. You know, we soft sell the word love. C.S. Lewis once said, we talk about God as a loving parent, but in reality, we don't want a loving father because a loving father is demanding and corrects us and all that. He said, most people really want a loving grandfather who is just content for all the kids to have a good time and to be mostly uninvolved. So that the pliability of the word love becomes a problem in the discussion, and people are talking past each other. We've heard people who have experienced same-sex attraction or even gender confusion say that they always remember being that way as early as they can remember, and their conclusion from that is that in some way they were therefore programmed that way. And so if they're programmed that way, that leads to their identity. This is who they are. It's how God made me, and you need to accept me that way. What are your thoughts on that, and how would you respond to that biblically as well?
Well, we know that most children cannot even recall or remember, most adults, I should say, cannot recall back into the earliest years of childhood. So it's usually 4 or 5, maybe 3 years old that we can recall childhood memories. So there is a lot we understand from research. There's a lot that happens within those first couple of years, even worldviews that are beginning to be set into place in those first 2-3 years of childhood. And so the idea that I could claim, and I understand it. I used to say this, what you just said, Joe, that I was born this way, that as far back as I can remember, I felt this way. So I get what it feels like to say that, to believe that to be true. But when you start to kind of open things up a little bit more. So one of the reasons I was tempted to say that is because it felt true, but also it would justify then in my mind what I was doing in my adulthood. And I think that's a kind of a powerful cocktail for coming up with a sense or a feeling that because I felt this way for as long as I can remember, it must be true. One of the things that we make distinction on is children do not feel sexually attracted to the same sex or any sex when they are 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, however, you know, years old. There are emotional things that children feel, deep senses of longing, perhaps, to the same sex, to in ways that aren't being satisfied in our current relationships. And then when those things become sexualized in teenage years, adulthood, then we can often look back and kind of rewrite our understanding of how we felt in this longing to fit in and this longing to be loved and accepted by our own gender. In this case, we can rewrite a lot of that into, oh, this is how I felt my whole life. Well, no, that's not. Sexual attraction isn't even something we're experiencing way back in the beginning.
And I would say biblically, the reality is that we're all born into sin and we're born in a fallen world. And so all of us have desires for things that go against God's word. And we want to hear where people are coming from. This is very important. We need to know why people think or feel that they were born that way. We need to hear their story and really listen and be compassionate, but then be able to say, you know, at the end of the day, we all need to be born again and born, you know, and that comes through faith in Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and we need to be compassionate and less judgmental in the wrong sense of that word, because we are all sinners, as you say. And yet, doesn't the Bible teach 1 Corinthians 6 through verses 9 through 11 in there that we have those broken states, but that doesn't mean we're stuck in them. It's not who we are, right? Scripture says, don't you know the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, greedy, drunkards, and so on. Those are described as kinds of sins that we all understand and we experience forms of them. But then, you know, the Apostle Paul writes, and such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. So what he's saying is, you identified those ways, that's what some of you were, and you no longer are.
Absolutely. And I would follow that with Galatians 2:20, which is, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And so I think it's so important to understand that in order to be identified with Christ, we need to be identified with his suffering. We need to crucify ourselves. We need to pick up our cross and follow him. And that's a process. So it's a moment of time when we're justified, but the process of sanctification takes a while. And that's what we're so passionate about, is we need brothers and sisters to walk alongside of us in that process of becoming more like Christ.
And what I love about what you guys do at the Love and Truth Network is getting down to the core question of identity. Joe, I think you mentioned it at the top, talking about symptoms versus the core issue at hand, the idea of identity. Gary, you mentioned being image bearers, made in the image of God. Why is that important? Well, it means that if we're made in God's image, then God is the one who gets to set the tone and pace and design for how life works best. I think the conversation I've had a few times with different people is going back to the very fundamentals of our desires and our wants and the things that we want to do, and to just ask the question, is anything wrong with anything? I've heard it put that way. Is anything wrong with anything? Most people will agree, sure, yes, there's things that are right and there are things that are wrong. Great. Who gets to determine what things are right and what things are wrong? Well, if you believe in God and you are a Christian especially, then you have to go to that as your source to say, okay, if God is the creator, God's the designer, God gets to set the pace and tone for that. And that gets to that fundamental question again of our identity being in Christ. And if it's not, something else takes precedence, then that's where all these other things are going to pop up, which we would call symptoms. I don't mean symptoms by being dismissive, like, oh, those things aren't important. Certainly, because these are all just extremely important things and can just be heartbreaking for families as we're walking through these types of things. But the foundational idea of identity, and really it kind of gets to this idea, we have a word in the church, lordship. Do we really see God as Lord? Do we see Jesus as Lord above all those other things? Can you talk about kind of the reordering that happens of both how this, if we put our identity in something other than Christ, how that the outcroppings of that can get us on the wrong path, and what that looks like to really say, no, Jesus is Lord, even over, especially over our desires and attractions?
One of the things we're seeing, and the example we use often, is that even within the church, we're seeing, but certainly within culture, we're seeing this, anyone who believes in that there is a God and that kind of thing, rather than aligning ourselves to the God who is revealed in the scriptures, we want to really, in many ways, remake God into our own image. Now, we may not be consciously aware we're doing that. In many cases, I think we probably aren't, but it's functionally how we're operating, even oftentimes in Christian settings. And our sense, by the way, of broken identity isn't just a broken identity within the LGBT world. There are plenty of heterosexual, opposite sex attracted men and women within the church who are identity confused because they're not choosing to press into and live out of the goodness and the fullness of what it means to be a man or a woman made in the image of God. How am I actually imaging God to my wife, my opposite sex, my opposite gendered wife, spouse, friends, what have you? How am I actually mirroring God in that way? That is a form of identity confusion if our identity is rooted in the image of God, that I'm a man or a woman made in his image. So I think that's really critical for us to wrestle with and understand that there are many ways that we are identity confused when it comes to this big, big topic, this foundational topic of what it means to be made in the image of God, male and female.
Yeah, absolutely. I had the conversation before that, you know, the conversation goes to the area of homosexuality and people saying, oh, so Christians are down on homosexuality. It's like, actually, we're in the realm of sexual activity, even more restrictive than that. Don't sell us short as Christians. In fact, God is so restrictive and he says, one man, one woman, one lifetime. That is the only bounds. And so there are plenty of ways that folks who have opposite sex attraction, same sex attraction, can get those things wrong. And so often, I think, again, the conversation turns to this idea of homosexuality when really sexual brokenness as a whole is a holistic identity issue.
Yeah, and it's interesting. Your perspective is we're even more restrictive. And I would say that's so in one sense. In another sense, I don't think of it as restrictive. I think of it as God's instructions for the ideal or the optimal type of human flourishing. I could build a machine and it has a particular use. Well, you could decide you want to use it underwater, you know, throwing it out of an airplane. You could come up with 100 uses for it and say, you're way too restrictive. And my answer would be, well, no, I built it to operate a certain way under certain conditions. And what I'm telling you is not to keep you from having fun or enjoying yourself. It's for you to use it appropriately according to its design. And I think we too often forget that what seems like a restriction, something that's designed to keep us from fun or pleasure of some sort, is actually helping our human flourishing. I won't go into details, but I didn't become a Christian until I was 25. I lived fully in the world and according to the world's values and all those things. And I would say the way that I lived brought me no deep sense of joy or peace or commitment or, you know, a loving commitment to a partner and a desire to see my wife become more like Christ. The joy that I've had since the time I became a believer, the sense of who I am and my flourishing and my sexuality is just part of that, is immeasurably better than what it was because I have a concept now of what God created or designed me for. So restrictive on the one hand, designed for human flourishing on the other.
Yeah, restrictive, maybe not the right word, but very specific design. And I love that word for human flourishing. This is how life works best.
To go back to your question, Brendan, about lordship, you know, Gary often shares that he grew up in a Christian family. And as a small child growing up in church, he prayed the prayer of salvation numerous times as really fire insurance, that he was praying so that he would be saved from hell. But there was no surrender to the lordship of Christ. And I think that's a very key distinctive. Is, again, if we are going to trust Jesus as our Lord and our Savior, then that means we need to surrender to who He is, what He says, and who He's made us to be. And so when we try to marry anything that the Bible says is sin to our Christian identity, in our opinion, we would say, there's not really an indication of surrender, if you will, to the lordship of Christ. If Christ is the head, then the Lord of my life, then He is first and everything else is second. And so I think that's really important.
Yeah, Gary, I want to go back to something you said earlier, and I think this is so important. I want to drill down a little bit on this. And that is, you know, we tend to be LGBTQ focused, but primarily because I think the public voices on that subject bring up the subject so often that it tends to get disproportionate attention. But when you talked about how our sexual nature is a part of, you know, the whole person God made us to be, and there's all sorts of sexual dysfunctions, you know, even as you're saying that, I'm thinking if you had a man who was married and heterosexual, but, you know, felt like every weekend he had to go out and, go to bars and be unfaithful to his wife and all of that. And at the same time, this, you know, person's addicted to pornography, as, by the way, many men and women in the church now are, sad to say. So we could look at something like that. Well, that's a kind of sexual dysfunction. There's something at the root of that that's driving that compulsive behavior. I think, you know, the great majority of Christians, even non-Christians, would look at that and say, that's a wrong thing. That's a violation of a covenant that man made with his wife. It's unhealthy. It's a type of dysfunction. So there are many dysfunctions that get imported into the sexual aspect of our humanity. So rather than focusing, you know, excessively on just one, I think what you're saying is really important, that we see it as a broader part of the human expression, what God has created us to be. And so, Gary, you actually deal with sexual dysfunction far more broadly. That's part of the ministry that you and Melissa have. I'd love to hear you expound on that a bit more.
Right, Joe. That's exactly what our ministry is about, is addressing the broad issues of sexual brokenness, which we believe that nearly all sexual brokenness is also the result of relational brokenness, and ways that sex becomes a really powerful counterfeit for authentic intimacy, as an example. And we were made for that. We were made for authentic intimacy, non-sexual intimacy even. And when we don't know how to meet those needs in healthy ways, those God-given legitimate needs in healthy ways, we meet them in illegitimate ways, often in terms of sexual sin, pornography, masturbation, hookups, fornication, adultery, what have you. And so, sadly, the church is far from immune from those issues. The church has much secret sin in regard to these things going on, you know, in our four walls, in our homes. And so we want to address those, not in terms of like shining a spotlight and sticking our nose in other people's business, but we know that Christians who have given their lives to Jesus have the Holy Spirit living inside of them. When we live in patterns of sin, no matter what that is, it is a miserable experience for us to be stuck in that place. And so we want to see people get free to actually fulfill their God-given purpose, of their eternal purpose on this planet, rather than being stuck from this time forward until, you know, the day they go home to be with Jesus, stuck in patterns of sin when it's unnecessary for them to be there.
Turning the focus to the church, and really part of the goal of this podcast is to equip the church to follow Jesus. That's our vision as a church. And we like to talk about these things on this podcast as a way to point people in our church and how to live faithfully, how to have these conversations in grace-filled, loving ways. And so talking about now, thinking about maybe families in our church, if we've got families who have kids who are coming out, again, it's almost Pride Month here as the recording of this, if kids are coming out saying, hey, I'm gay, I have the same-sex attraction, maybe these are even families who say, hey, we want to live faithfully the way that the Bible lays out what Orthodox Christianity looks like, but I've got this same-sex attraction, I don't know what to do with this, why would I have this struggle to wrestle with? How is it fair that my friends who have opposite sex attraction get to live that out eventually and getting married and have these relationships? I've got the same sex attraction, which the Bible really just closes the door on that. How do I live this faithful life when I have these attractions and desires? How do you guys go about having those conversations?
Yeah, that's a great question and so important, because I feel like often we've tried to give simple answers to really hard, complex issues. And so the reality is there's no guarantee that a person who is exclusively same-sex attracted would be able to grow into other sex attraction. But what we would say is God can do anything. And so am I willing, or is that person willing to pursue Jesus and maybe a program that would help identify any of some of the brokenness, like what we've shared, or anything that God might want to do in terms of their own life experiences or their views of men or women, their own view of themselves, and just pursue kind of a discipleship journey, but also maybe a healing journey, and be open to God growing them beyond or in spite of their same-sex attraction. That doesn't mean that everyone will get married or anything like that. But I think because we want to be quote-unquote compassionate to those that are exclusively same-sex attracted, there's been this move in the church to say, well, yeah, it's okay to just identify as a gay celibate Christian. And we're like, no, that's like closing the horizon down. We don't think that that lines up biblically. We've already talked about that. Putting anything, marrying anything to your Christian identity is not a good idea. And actually, it's like, it's futile. We would say that that would be extremely hard and depressing to live in that space where we're basically saying there is no option for anything other than celibacy.
Well, and I think obviously the scriptures teach about a gift of celibacy. And so it's not that celibacy is a wrong thing or bad thing. I mean, that we can be celibate and really focused on our relationship with Jesus. And also we live in an age of a lot of coddling, and I wanted to be coddled in all of my desires and all of my loneliness and many different ways. And the reality that nobody is guaranteed the satisfaction or the joy of a sexual relationship, and no one dies without it either. And that doesn't mean, and when I say that, I know that sounds crass. I'm not trying to be crass. That's just the reality of things. We desire deep relationship for people who are longing for that. But one of the things that we believe is a root issue here is that when Psalm 68:6 says that God takes the lonely and puts them in family, we are not the kind of family in the body of Christ that Jesus died to make us. There are walls between us, invisible walls that are very thick and impenetrable. And I think that we have a high view of the nuclear family, and I think that we should have a high view of that, but we should also have a high view of inviting single individuals and other hurting people into our families to do life together. We love Rosaria Butterfield's book, The Gospel Comes with a House Key. She really unpacks that topic really, really well. I think there are so many people who are hurting and desperate for relationship that could find meaningful relationship. It's not the same thing as a sexual relationship with a partner that you're married to. I understand that. But there's so much that could be satisfied in these deeper family bonds and relationships that extend into the eternal family of God outside and beyond the nuclear family of God that we have. The church has a lot of room to grow in.
Yeah, those are great thoughts. We're created for relationship. And not to miss the obvious point here, the first and most important relationship that we are created for is our personal relationship with Jesus Christ, our relationship with God. And very often, even Christians fall into this kind of formulaic understanding of the faith. Oh, it's an aspect of who I am. I go to church. I read this book. I meet with my men's group. And we don't always recall that we're meant for personal relationship, intimacy with God, a prayer closet where we have personal time with God. We come to know Him. His Holy Spirit lives in us. And this is going to sound like an oversimplification, but in a way it really isn't. In listening to people who have dealt with countless problems I've encountered over the years and decades, whether they're sexual relationships, corrupt business dealings, drug issues, or whatever, it seems there's a moment, it's like the parable of the prodigal son where Jesus said, he's in the pig pen, and when he came to himself, there's a moment that hits us where we desire God, we desire pleasing our Father more than anything else. And it seems like whatever these misdirected desires are of any sort, I've heard people say over and over, I just wanted God more than I wanted that. And once we desire the lordship of Christ over anything and we want to please Him, it's just interesting the way these other desires fall away. They lose their power. They lose their grip over us. It really starts with that intense desire for the presence of God in our lives and getting to know Jesus more intimately. I've heard that articulated by our common friend, our dear friend, Walt Heyer. We were speaking just recently, in fact. There's a movie coming about his transition. And for those listeners who are not familiar, Walt is a man who presented as a woman and lived as a woman for about 8 years, had gender confusion, had a dramatic turning to Christ, a dramatic inner healing, detransitioned, has a detransitioning ministry. You can find him. It's Walt Heyer, H-E-Y-E-R. He's all over the internet. And he has described exactly this kind of thing, his personal encounter with Christ that led him to this healing. And he was mentioning to me that there's a movie coming out about, and he called it his redemption. The movie is The Movie Who, WHOMI.com. And we love these kinds of resources. I know that you all have hearts for people. Give us your website again. Talk about some of your books, resources. How can people get a hold of you if they've got questions?
Sure. Melissa said earlier, our website is loveandtruthnetwork.com. And you can find us there. You can find our podcast either in video or in audio. We produce one each week. And that is either at loveandtruthnetwork.com/podcast or at any of your favorite podcast platforms. And I wrote a book recently about my life story up to the age of accepting Christ as my Lord and Savior at 23 years old. And that is out on Amazon. The title of that is Am I Gay? And the other resources, we have e-courses, we do a lot of travel, speaking, and full weekend ministry events. Our desire is to work with churches who want to see that, not just bring in a good program, but understand that the environment of their church, this don't ask, don't tell kind of unspoken rule in the church, that people can't get real, that we have to hide in the shadows. We talk about realness. We talk about gospel. We talk a lot. We use a lot of the right language, but then practically speaking, all of us are living double lives. All of us are hiding parts of ourselves that are shameful from everybody else around us. Again, that is antithetical to the gospel. That is antithetical to the life that Christ died to give us. And so we want to work with churches that have a desire to shift the environment of their church, not just bring in a good program, because good programs don't functionally work well in an environment that is shrouded in secrecy and particularly sexual sin.
So thankful for you guys and your resources. I guess maybe as a good way to close would be, there's the false narrative that our world is giving folks who are experiencing same-sex attraction or what they're trying to figure out to do with their desires. The lie is that the only way to find true happiness and meaning is to exercise those desires in their full and totality. And what we are saying is that's a false narrative. The real narrative is to lean into our identity in Christ, and that's the only direction in which we'll find the fulfillment. In the work that you guys are doing, both in your own lives and the work that you're doing with churches and mentoring and counseling different people who are walking through these types of things, how are you seeing God work in making that a reality? Not the false narrative, but the true narrative of identity in Christ working its way out.
We are seeing that happen as we walk alongside people that are struggling with either identity confusion or same-sex attractions. We're also really excited when we see churches that we've visited and we're pouring into several years in a row, and we're actually seeing their environments change, and we're seeing people experience authentic community. That's really where the change is happening. And we're really, really excited about that. And so it's a privilege to walk with those that are hurting and to really equip others to carry on, this work.
And right along with that, the last thing I would say is that there's no greater way that we can identify with Jesus than to obey his teaching in Matthew 16, where Jesus says, if you want to be my follower, if you want to be my disciple, you must deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow after me. That is the posture of every true disciple of Christ, is that we are willing to deny our natural fleshly desires, whatever those might be. When I say deny them, I don't mean pretend that they're not there, but to not give in to them, to not cultivate them, to take up our crosses and follow after Jesus. That is a path that leads ultimately toward life and toward satisfaction.
So well said. Gary and Melissa, thank you so much for being our guest today, coming and sharing your hearts and from the, just kind of the richness of the resources you've accumulated over many years. We wish you Godspeed in your journey, and keep up the good work. It was a delight having you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
As always, if this has been helpful for you, this conversation, we invite you to share it with others. Subscribe to Viewpoint on whatever podcast app that you prefer. Follow along with us. We have some great conversations coming up yet this year as we continue to look at this intersection of how the Bible speaks to the issues that we face every single day in our culture. If you've got show ideas, if you've got questions, you can always email us at viewpoint@highlandschurch.org. That's viewpoint@highlandschurch.org. We would love to hear from you. Hop into iTunes, leave us a rating and review. Again, that's how the algorithms know to serve this content up as something that is helpful and useful to others. So feel free to drop us a line there as well. But we will look forward to having you all with us on our next conversation.